At the famous San Diego Zoo's Safari Park lies a zoo within a zoo, whose fences and animals have been replaced with liquid nitrogen and cell cultures.
This is San Diego's frozen zoo. That's right, zoo. It's not the one you grew up visiting, but one in which there are living cells from over 1,000 species preserved and frozen, all to help and protect future generations of animals currently facing extinction. What was the genesis for creating the frozen zoo?
The possibility to save cells allowed us to undertake research right from the beginning that was relevant to reproducing endangered species. Each cell of an individual is capable of producing the entire individual.
Can you walk me through the process of freezing cells?
We get a biopsy, a small piece of tissue. We can take those cells and treat them so they can be frozen and put it in suspended animation.
You say suspended animation. Can you explain that a little bit more?
Well, when you take a living cell, you can then freeze it to a very, very low temperature, like the temperature of liquid nitrogen, and all cellular activity basically stops. And in their state of suspended animation, can be thawed and in 20 minutes be growing again.
The notion of freezing and thawing cells is fascinating. And with Dr. Ryder's help, we gained a clearer perspective.
This is the frozen zoo. The cells are in racks, in towers, in an inventory system here, and they are in the vapor of liquid nitrogen, 250 degrees below zero. You can look down now because we've clarified it and see the towers that hold the cells of the frozen zoo. They're the cells of over 10,000 individual animals.
This isn't exactly your traditional zoo. Would you say the definition of zoo has changed with this type of technique?
Well, zoos have greatly expanded their mission from menageries. They are now conservation organizations. The zoos of the future will have activities like preserving these kinds of samples as a core part of their mission.
The cells of many endangered animals, like the giant panda and western lowland gorilla, are also kept at the frozen zoo. But none is both closer to extinction in Dr. Ryder's heart than the northern white rhino.
They are amazing. As big as they are, I think they're more like ballerinas than anything else. And they are exquisite products of nature. What amazing animals a rhino is. There may be 7 white rhinos left, but how many reproductive individuals are there? There are at the most 4, and those are all very highly related. Inbred populations cannot survive as well as ones that have higher genetic diversity. And that's where the notion of genetic rescue can come in.
The goal of genetic rescue is to restore an endangered species to full genetic health. With today's rapidly improving genetic technologies, the cells at the frozen zoo could be used to reproduce healthy offspring for these endangered populations. A revolutionary genetic development occurred in January when a team of Boston and Japanese researchers found a remarkable new and easy way of creating stem cells from mice. Stem cells are capable of becoming any cell type in the body, and this new discovery is promising.
Well, it's huge. Nobody knows whether it's possible in the rhino, but if it could be done in the mouse, why not in the rhino?
The hope is to transform stem cells from a northern white rhino into both egg and sperm cells to create a white rhino embryo.
We would have to embryo transfer it into a surrogate. The surrogate would be southern white rhinos, which are more plentiful and which we have reproducing here at the San Diego Zoo Safari Park.
That is 1,800 acres of San Diego Zoo's Safari Park. Within there are over 330 species of animals, half of which are protected, or worse, endangered.
Rhinos everywhere have been hunted down because of the mistaken belief in the medicinal healing powers of the rhino horn.
What do you think is going to happen?
Without change from the current trajectory, they're doomed.
The film Jurassic Park depicted the technological process of reviving an already extinct species and helped the viewing public imagine the possibilities of de-extinction science. But the science and research of reviving long-gone species is very real and very controversial, often raising more questions than answers. To enter that debate, we visited the paleogenetic lab of Dr. Beth Shapiro at the University of California at Santa Cruz. What is your research with ancient DNA aimed at?
Ancient DNA is a technique that can be used to get genetic information from animals and plants that lived in the past.
De-extinction. Do you think it's doable in the foreseeable future?
I'm not sure that making a 100% exact replica of a genome of something will ever be possible. This is one of the reasons that people interested in de-extinction of the mammoth, for example, use recently developed genome editing techniques to make specific changes in the genomes of an animal that's still alive to make it look more like the genome of the animal that you're trying to de-extinct. What you would need to know are the places in the genome. Say you were using an elephant, for example. The places in the elephant genome that differed from the mammoth genome. And then you would be able to have an elephant that has some of the characteristics of a mammoth. For example, tolerance to cold or longer hair.
So tell me more about this genome editing. Is that possible?
That is doable. That part is doable today. And the technology to do multiple changes at once is being developed as we speak.
There's some people in science that say if a species has gone extinct, there's a reason for it. We should just let it be. How do you feel about that?
If we have solved the problem that caused the extinction in the first place, then and only then can we begin to think about what the other consequences of bringing that species back would be.
The plight of the passenger pigeon is both a dramatic story of extinction and a popular topic for de-extinction. In the 1700s, their numbers were estimated at 3 billion. But because their flocks were huge, they were easily hunted. By the 1920s, they were extinct.
I think that the passenger pigeon has been extinct for such a long time that the habitat that it lived in is probably gone. In the case of where something is very recently extinct or on the verge of extinction, it might be that the niche is still vacant. And by filling that vacated niche, we might stabilize the community. And in doing so, actually save other species that might have gone extinct if that niche had been left vacant.
Why should we preserve endangered species around the world?
We have inherited the Earth from our ancestors. It's our responsibility to pass it on to our descendants.
Only on Al Jazeera America.
A team of scientists are taking their inspiration from nature.
Technology is a vital part of who we are.
They had some dynamic fire behavior.
And what we do.
Transcranial direct stimulation. Don't try this at home.
TechKnow's team of experts show you how the miracles of science.
This is my selfie. What can you tell me about my future?
Can affect and surprise us.
Sharks like affection.
Catch new episodes of TechKnow on Al Jazeera America. Check your local listings or visit aljazeera.com.